Good morning. Welcome to St. John Presbyterian Church. My name is Alan, and I'm the pastor here. We have one change in the bulletin, and that is the closing hymn is actually number 439 instead of 447. So when we get to the closing hymn, it's 439 instead of 447. Taste of Southern Indiana is this week. So if you want to get tickets, they're still available. You can get those through the church office or by going to Hope Southern Indiana or RSVP. Our street fair is coming up on September 10th. We need 2 liters and children's books. And we also need volunteers. Peggy? So buy one, get one free at J.C. and Kroger. The following Sunday is the church picnic on September 11th at the Napis' house. There's a sign-up sheet inside your bulletin that you can sign up. Let us know what you're bringing. And you can fill that out and place it in the offering plate as it comes around. We're rolling dough every morning still at 8 a.m., and Sherry?
We're about 3/4 of the way done, so we shipped 3,100 in the last week. We would really love to get done on Thursday, and we could try to get some topics earlier part of the week, but we'd love to get finished on Thursday, so we can all get ready for a while.
All right, so if you have the morning available, they'd like to get done by Thursday. So, check with Sherry if you want to roll. That said, we'll need to be thinking of volunteering for the weekend. We'll need bakers, especially this year, and booth workers, as always. Any other announcements? Jacqueline?
I have a joy.
What's your joy?
My joy is that my husband and I will be married 26 years on Wednesday.
Yay. Thank you, sweetheart. Other announcements? Then how about more joys and concerns? Denny Sumner is in U of L Hospital. We had surgery last night and needs our prayers. Peggy? And that's Gilead. Okay, Gilead. Karen?
We had a great turnout yesterday at Cuyahoga for the 70th anniversary. We had a great representation from St. John. We can reference to a former pastor here who kind of helped develop a work program.
Cool. So a good day at Pioca, and thank you all for those who came out. Kathy?
Prayers for my neighbor
today. Oh. So we'll pray for Kathy's neighbor, Debbie. Other joys or concerns? Melissa? Yay! So Connor and Jake are engaged. Other joys? Anna?
Mm-hmm.
So fundraiser for my club's Christmas party are special ornaments that Nancy Childress has made. So feel free to donate and take some of those with you this afternoon. Other announcements or joys or concerns? All right, seeing none, we'll begin worship by inviting Charlie to share his prelude.
Able and join me in the call to worship. God of the past, who whispered in the prophet's ears, who rescued us from sin's slavery, we are here to thank you. God of the future, who is tearing down the old world and building your kingdom in our midst, we are here because we trust you. God of the present, who in the giftedness of our diversity creates us to be one people. God of life that surprises us when we find it within us. Please join me in a confession of sin. Merciful God, pardon all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not done justice, loved kindness, or walked humbly with you, O God. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness, in your great compassion, cleanse us from our sin. Do not cast us away from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from us. Restore us to salvation, and sustain us from your bountiful Spirit. The good news is that God forgives us. Forgive others and forgive yourselves. Thanks be to God. Be seated. The first reading is from Ruth 2, 1 through 13. Now Naomi had a kinsman on her husband's side, a prominent rich man of the family of Elimelech, whose name was... Let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain behind someone in whose sight I find favor. She said to her, "Go, my daughter." So she went. She came and gleaned in the field behind the reapers. As it happened, she came in the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Just then Boaz came from Bethlehem. He said to the reapers, "The Lord be with you." They answered, "The Lord bless you." Then Boaz said to his servant, who was in charge of the reapers, "To whom does this young woman belong?" The servant who was in charge of the reapers answered, "She is the Moabite who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab." She said, "Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the reapers." So she came, and she has been on her feet from early this morning until now, without resting even for a moment. Then Boaz said to Ruth, "Now listen, my daughter. Do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Keep your eyes on the field that is being reaped and follow behind them. I have ordered the young men not to bother you. If you get thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn." Then she fell prostrate with her face to the ground and said to him, "Why have I found favor in your sight, that you should take notice of me when I am a foreigner?" But Boaz answered her, "All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. May the Lord reward you for your deeds, and may you have a full reward from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." Then she said, "May I continue to find favor in your sight, my Lord? For you have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, even though I am not one of your servants." This ends the first reading.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, I am on my way, bound for Jubilee. Hallelujah, hallelujah, I am on my way, bound for Jubilee. Oh, my brother, won't you come with me? Oh, my sister, you must come today. Oh, hallelujah, bound for jubilee.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, bound for jubilee. My Lord's calling, I must go with him. Can't you hear him calling you today? Might come and take me away, for I get to jubilee.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, bound for jubilee.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, bound for
Thank you, Dr. Mitchell and the men's ensemble. Our reading continues with verse 14 of chapter 2. At mealtime, Boaz said to Ruth, "Come here and eat some of this bread, and dip your morsel in the sour wine." So she sat behind the reapers, and he heaped up for her some parched grain. She ate until she was satisfied, and she had some left over. When she got up to glean, Boaz instructed his young men, "Let her glean even among the standing sheaves, and do not reproach her. You must also pull out some handfuls for her from the bundles and leave them for her to glean, and do not rebuke her." So she gleaned in the field until evening. Then she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. She picked it up and came into town, and her mother-in-law saw how much she had gleaned. Then she took out and gave her what was left over after she herself had been satisfied. Her mother-in-law said to her, "Where did you glean today, and where have you worked? Blessed be the man who took notice of you." So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, "The name of the man with whom I work today is Boaz." Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, "Blessed be he by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead." Naomi also said to her, "The man is a relative of ours, one of our nearest kin." Then Ruth the Moabite said, "He even said to me, 'Stay close by my servants until they have finished all my harvest.'" Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, "It is better, my daughter, that you should go out with his young women. Otherwise, you might be bothered in another field." So she stayed close to the young women of Boaz, gleaning until the end of the barley and wheat harvests. And she lived with her mother-in-law. It's the word of God for the people of God. Ruth wasn't one to sit idly by. She took measures to provide for herself and her mother-in-law, even though she was a stranger in a new land. She did what common poor people did. She went and gleaned in the fields. The Bible said, "When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyards bare or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God." That comes from Leviticus 19, 9 to 10. And it describes a common practice that the poor and the alien, the widow and the orphan, would go during the harvest and glean what they could from the field. It was with some foreshadowing that Ruth hoped she would glean behind someone who's in whose sight I might find favor. Naomi agreed with her daughter-in-law's decision and sent her off to glean. As it happened, the Bible said, funny thing about the Bible is that nothing just happens. We already learned this with Naomi, that people believe that everything that happened, good or bad, was by the hand of God. Well, it just so happened that Ruth came to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Boaz had previously been described as a prominent rich man, a kinsman on Naomi's husband's side. Though the characters in the story don't know it yet, the reader's ears are attentive, knowing that this close relative could be the one to redeem Ruth and in turn, Naomi. Close relatives were tasked with taking on any debt, buying back any property, and/or marrying a widow of his relative. He was known as the redeemer of the family. We must not rush to any conclusions yet, though, for Boaz had to choose to take on the role, and the law said nothing about doing such for a foreigner. When he comes onto the scene, he particularly asks about Ruth, either by curiosity or certain attraction. The chief servant said, "She is the Moabite who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab." Boaz immediately made provisions for Ruth to be well taken care of. He told her to keep close to his young women, that he had ordered the young men not to bother her. Gleaning obviously was a dangerous venture, with young women being exposed to violence or abuse by young men working in the field. He told her that if she got thirsty, she should drink from the water that the young men had drawn. Earlier, Ruth had hoped she would find favor in someone whose field to glean who would show her favor. When she received it, she was overwhelmed and fell to the ground saying, "Why have I found favor in your sight that you should take notice of me when I am a foreigner?" Boaz replied that he had heard all that Ruth had done for Naomi, how you left your mother and father and native land and came to a people that you did not know before. He prayed that she would have a full reward from the Lord, under whose wings she had come for refuge. This is a familiar way of referring to God's protection and care, God's shelter and refuge. Like a mother hen caring for and protecting her young, the Lord spreads God's wings over those who need the love and support that only God can provide. The ironic thing is that Boaz was serving as those wings, offering Ruth protection and care. Further, the reward that Ruth would eventually receive would be by the hand of Boaz as well. But we don't want to get ahead of ourselves. Let's look at how far we've come. Last week, we talked about how Ruth had converted to Naomi's God as part of her promise to her. And whereas before that God was known as one who had dealt harshly with Naomi, here the same God is blessing Ruth, since she just so happened to find herself gleaning in the field of Boaz. She was learning about divine providence and how it works, and we are too. When it comes to God's providence, there's no such thing as happenstance. Some refer to them as happy accidents. I once knew a woman who fell and bruised her rib, which was painful enough. But when they were checking her out, they found a tumor, which was small. They were able to treat it, and eventually she was cancer-free. But they never would have found that tumor had she not bruised her rib, and it would have grown and might have become unmanageable. Such is God's providence at work. Had my wife's wedding dress not been made at a theater company, which had taken up residence at a seminary, I might not have gone there myself to study and be where I am today. There, I just so happened to have a Presbyterian advisor. I just so happened to intern at a Presbyterian church and ended up getting ordained as a Presbyterian minister. Again, that's God's providence at work. Boaz, though, wasn't done lavishing favor on Ruth. When it came time for supper, Boaz invited her to eat with him and his reapers. Further, he himself served her as he heaped up for her some of the parched grain. She ate so that she was satisfied and even had some left over. But Boaz still wasn't done. He instructed his young men to let her glean among the standing sheaves rather than just pick up what was on the ground. Further, he told them to pull out some handfuls for her from the bundles and leave them for her to glean. When all was said and done, by day's end, she had gleaned an ephah of barley, which amounted to 3/5 of a bushel, or enough to sustain her and Naomi for several weeks. When Naomi found out where Ruth had been all day, she said, "Blessed be he by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead. This man is a relative of ours, one of our nearest kin." What a change of mood for Naomi. Before, she had felt forsaken, that the Lord had dealt harshly with her. She wanted to be called Mara because of all the bitterness she felt. But here it was as if she had been brought to life. Her faith had been restored. She saw in the circumstances God's chesed, God's loving kindness and mercy and favor. God had not forgotten her after all. And she saw in Boaz's treatment of Ruth goodwill towards her deceased husbands and sons as well. For God had provided for the widows. This is how it is with God. Just as we try to count God out, God can be counted on to show us favor. Just when we think we've been left for dead, God can bring us back to life. Just when we think things will only get worse, something comes along for the better. God is always working God's plans behind the scenes. Just because there are times when we feel things don't go our way, they are always going God's way. Joy may not come always in the morning, but it'll come. Hope may seem desperate, but it's always present. In the end, Naomi encouraged her to stay near and go out with his young women so as not to be bothered in another man's field. So Ruth worked for another several months until the end of the barley and the wheat harvests. Note that even though Boaz had made provisions for her, Ruth still had to work hard. Gleaning was no easy task. It was long hours on one's feet, stooping and picking up fallen sheaves. But because of her hard work and trust in Boaz's favor, Ruth was able to provide for her and her mother-in-law. At first, it seemed they were going back to Bethlehem in defeat. but things quickly revealed that moving back was the best decision they could have made. Jesus is our Redeemer. He just so happens to bless us in abundant ways every day. He is in the blessing business. When it feels like we are forsaken, we take comfort knowing that he felt forsaken on his cross, but he hung on because he knew that his would be a ransom for many. His was a life full of providence. There were no accidents or coincidences when it came to him. He perfectly followed God's plan, even though that meant rejection, betrayal, suffering, and death. He accepted that all as God's plan. And the Bible tells us that when we suffer, we should consider it a joy because Christ suffered too. But that didn't stop him from doing what he came to do, and that was to redeem us all. Like Ruth, though, we can't sit back and trust that he'll do everything for us. Life requires us to put in the work like Ruth did. She spent long days in the field as her part of receiving God's blessing. Boaz didn't decide to deliver wheat and barley to Naomi's home. Ruth had to work for it, though Boaz made her job that much easier. The same is true of Jesus. He has work for us to do. We have to, as the Bible says, work out our salvation with fear and trembling. But Jesus makes our job that much easier. He has freed us from the chains of sin and the fear of death. He has given us access to the Holy Spirit, who is even now at work in us and through us. For Ruth, her part in the reception of her salvation was to glean in the fields. Though favored by Boaz, her status hadn't changed. She was still a poor immigrant, at least for now. Yet Ruth was blessed abundantly, most of all because she had found a refuge under the wings of God, spread through Boaz's kindness. May we find refuge under the wings of God and know that we are being blessed, protected, and cared for. We should do our part to stay within that refuge, to know that it's always there, especially when we're down and seemingly forsaken. God has plans for us. And we should do our part to work in God's field to glean what we can for the harvest. For there are souls who get lost and left behind. We may not be the greatest of evangelists, but we can do what we can to glean just one soul left behind or cast aside. For there are many out there who feel bitter or forsaken. Let us tell them that that's not the end of the story for them. God has plans, and it might just so happen that tomorrow or the next day you stumble into the field where God has a yield for you. Amen. Thank you. Join me in our affirmation of faith, which comes from the brief statement. We trust in God, whom Jesus called Abba Father. In sovereign love, God created the world good and makes everyone equally in God's image, male and female of every race and people, to live as one community. But we rebel against God. We hide from our Creator, ignoring God's commandments. We violate the image of God in others and ourselves, accept lies as truth, exploit neighbor and nature, and threaten death to the planet entrusted to our care.
We deserve God's
condemnation. Yet God acts with justice and mercy to redeem creation. In everlasting love, the God of Abraham and Sarah chose a covenant people to bless all the families of the earth. Hearing their cry, God delivered the children of Israel from the house of bondage. Loving us still, God makes us heirs with the Christ of the covenant. Like a mother who will not forsake her nursing child, like a father who runs to welcome the prodigal home, God is faithful still. Let us pray. Creator God, we thank you for the summer storms that come along and stir up the leaves and the trees and down fallen branches and bring hailstones to the ground. Redeemer God, we thank you for freeing us from the chains of sin and death, and freeing us to live a life in Christ. Sustaining God, you carry us through the good times and the bad times, always with blessings ready to be poured out among us. Sanctify us and renew us in a right spirit, so that we may walk in newness of life with Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Be with our church as we come to a busy time. Be with RSVP this week as they pull together their big fundraiser, Taste of Southern Indiana. Be with us as we get ready for Harvest Homecoming and the street fair, and as we join together for the church picnic. Continue to strengthen our witness so that we might bring more people into this family of God. Help us to do what good we can for our brothers and sisters and our neighbors. Help us to continue to shine a light in our community as we have for over 200 years. Be with the church and our community. Unite our witness so that we might together share the unity of the gospel that we know and love and proclaim together. Help us overcome our divisions and do what we can that we are a church united in New Albany. Be with those churches who do not worship with the freedoms we have and who do so under the risk of imprisonment or death. Almighty God, be with our nation and its many decisions that they face, that we face together. Be with our elected officials who serve us and help them do so in a cooperative, bipartisan way that seeks the common good for all people, not just the select few. Be with those who lead us at the state and local level as well. We pray for the people of Eastern Kentucky continuing to clean up after the floods. We ask that you be with those who were affected by last night's storm. Be with those who are going through divorces and children who are caught in custody battles. Be with those families who live paycheck to paycheck and struggle to put food on the table. And thank you for social service agencies like Hope Southern Indiana and Salvation Army who do what they can to provide food for those who are in want. Be with those who battle addiction and those who are experiencing sobriety. Be with our homeless as they struggle to find a way just to exist and to do so with respect and dignity. Be with our men and women who serve us in the armed forces, and be with our first responders. Be with those who are in war-torn countries like the Ukraine. Be with those who are refugees left behind by war or violence. Be with the poor and the immigrant, as we learned about in Scripture today, and help us do our part to support them as the Bible teaches. Be the wisdom for the one who has a decision they have to make. Be strength for the one who is facing a trial. Be courage for the one who is facing an enemy. Be hope for the hopeless and love for the unloved. Lord, we pray for Denny as he recovers from his surgery. Bless Jacqueline and I on our 26th wedding anniversary. Be with the family of Dave Gillian in their time of loss. Bless Pioca on their 70th year, and we thank you for the celebration that was had this weekend. Be with Kathy's neighbor, Debbie, who needs you desperately. And blessings on Connor and Jake on their engagement. These are those we have named here today, Lord, but there are others that we have kept to ourselves. Let us share those in a moment of silence, knowing that you hear our prayers, even if they are from our hearts. Give us wisdom to know that your answers come in your way, and patience knowing that they come in your time. Hear us as we pray. Holy Spirit, unite our hearts with all the saints on earth and in heaven as we confidently pray as Jesus taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us give as we are able, as our ushers come forward to collect the offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, thank you for the gifts that you've given us. Take what we are able to offer and use it to encourage, equip, and inspire your people through the ministry of our church. We pray this through Christ, who is the greatest gift of all, and in his name, amen.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you have taught us that our deeds are worth nothing. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love,
the very bond of peace and of all goodness.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord,
who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
one God, now and forever. Amen.
May the light of Christ surround you. May the love of Father God enfold you. May the power of Holy Spirit protect you, and may the presence of God watch over you. And remember, wherever you are, God is, and all will be well. Go in peace.